I just wanted to thank everyone who has joined the session today. Thank you for tuning in today. As part of our initiative to help build strong foundation, we started the NEET PG Prep series in April. The aim of the series was to provide important insight into exam preparation by a subject matter expert from Elsevier. In our today's session, we will be covering ophthalmology for NEET PG exam. And we will be discussing on common ocular disorders, their clinical features and management. To help us through that, we have with us Dr. Radhika Tandon today. Welcome, ma'am. Dr. Tandon is a professor of ophthalmology at AIIMS Delhi. She herself is a graduate of AIIMS Delhi and she's a leading academician with 30 years of experience in medical teaching. She's also the co-author of book Parsons Diseases of the Eye, which is published by Elsevier. Parsons Diseases of the Eye has served as a trusted textbook of ophthalmology for undergraduates for over 100 years. And over the years, the book has maintained its clinical relevance through periodic revisions and suitable updates, and hence retained its prime position at the top of its field. And today, we will be asking Dr. Tandon some pertinent questions. And if you have burning questions of your own, please share them in the chat and we will ask them for you in the end. Ma'am, to start of the session, if we can just get some idea on what are the crucial concepts in ophthalmology that candidates should prioritize for preparing for the exam.
Yes, thank you so much for arranging this and giving me the opportunity to share my knowledge and experience. So in a nutshell, I would say that in preparing for the exam, students have to also always keep in view a focus. One is, of course, they have to clear the exam, but the way the exam is oriented is to encourage the students to acquire adequate knowledge to be able to handle an ophthalmic patient's needs. So you have to always have a little clinical orientation or a practical approach that makes it so much easier, then the subject becomes more interesting. And the information you read will or learn will remain with you both for the exam and for later on. Now, regarding the key concepts, they can vary a lot, but certain basic principles are universal to any medical practice, and the same are relevant to ophthalmology. So history taking skills and the clinical examination and the planning for investigations and outline for treatment. And then you have to realize that how is ophthalmic care or the ophthalmic patient workup or the knowledge going to be different. So a few things are important. One has two eyes and one will always like to have the information of both of them. Vision is a very important aspect about what one is asking. In addition, the usual, what are the presenting complaints related to the comfort and the duration of the symptoms, the nature of the symptoms. And you always have to correlate the type of symptoms that the patient is having with the age of the patient, because a similar symptom in a young person may have a different differential diagnosis as compared to an older person. So everything has to be in context. So when taking the history, you should know what are the key symptom complexes that you get with eye disorders. Then you have to know what is the proper approach to doing the examination and build a differential diagnosis. And you should have an idea as to what should be the management plan, which would mean investigations, confirmation of the diagnosis, and going ahead with the treatment.
So, ma'am, you talked about tests and other things. So, what are the key tests the candidate should be familiar with when concerning the NEET PG exam?
So for the PG exam, they should be familiar with the full range of tests which are required. So there would be the clinical assessment and then further investigations to confirm the diagnosis. So there could be ocular investigations and there could be systemic investigations. Mm-hmm. Because there are many eye disorders where the eye may be the first manifestation of a systemic disorder. At the same time, there are many systemic diseases which may affect the eye as well. So often you would have to have both ophthalmic tests tests as well as the investigation for the systemic conditions. The other thing is that you may have a pure ophthalmic condition, say glaucoma or cataract, and you're planning the surgery, but the patient may have an underlying silent systemic disease. They may have associated diabetes or hypertension, which may be undetected or undiagnosed or unknown. And then when you plan for surgery, if you don't take care of those conditions, it can have complications during surgery, such as if there's uncontrolled hypertension, the patient may have excessive bleeding, or sometimes may have some other event during the surgery. If the patient has uncontrolled diabetes or undetected diabetes, it affects their wound healing as well as their ability to combat infections, and they may come back with postoperative complications.
Right. So, ma'am, in terms of, so how do you approach tackling image-based questions and recognize critical features in clinical images?
Yes, so this is extremely important, and one should have a tailored approach. So one would not ask for all the investigations for every patient based upon your clinical differential diagnosis or your initial assessment. You will ask for appropriate investigations. Now, when you talk about image-based investigations, they could be for corneal disorders, they could be for glaucoma, they could be for retinal disorders. For corneal disorders, you may have images which are looking at the topography, that is the shape of the cornea, the curvature of the cornea. There could be investigations where, such as a pentacam or a Schemflug tomography. Whereas if you're looking at the cross-section of the cornea, you would have what is called as anterior segment OCT, optical coherence tomography, where you'll have a cross-section of the cornea. Then there you would be looking at the thickness of the cornea, the contour of the cornea. If there's any opacity visible, any abnormality, where is it located? Is it central? Is it peripheral? What is the depth to which it is affecting? Is it just anterior, stromal, or involving the full thickness of the cornea, and so on? So if you're preparing an image, if you're getting a full overview of the image-based investigations, you have to understand what is the type of investigation. Is it an optical investigation, such as involving the transparency, or is it a mapping investigation where you're just getting an idea of the contour, or whether it is a further detailed investigation such as confocal microscopy, where you can go to the cellular level? Then you should know what is the purpose of the investigation, and you should be able to assess how to describe the image. So you should be able to identify whether it's of the right eye or the left eye. You should be able to say what is the investigation. Is it an OCT picture? Is it a ConfoScan picture? I'm talking about the cornea. Similarly, you can have investigations for the posterior segment, such as we can have imaging of the optic nerve head. For glaucoma, you would be having again OCT, which would show you the optic head cupping, the extent of the cupping, the RNFL layer, the retinal nerve fiber layer thickness, the pattern of distribution. Then if you're looking at an image of the retina, it could be just a simple fundus photograph, which could be showing you a variety of disorders. You could be seeing new vessels, you could be seeing a pale disc, you could be seeing exudates. So you have to have a systematic approach. The first thing you should know is how to identify these various images. You should be able to describe whether it is a retina, cornea, or optic nerve head, which is being visualized. Then what is the nature of the investigation? And then you look for the abnormalities. Sometimes if they are shown an image in an exam, the candidates are not very sure whether it's normal or abnormal. Or when they're first shown, they get a little nervous. So then they should start having a broad-based description, and then try to identify whether what is the most important lesion of interest. So talk about that first. Say, for example, if you're shown a fundus fluorescein angiogram and you see an abnormality like a leaking vessel, then you have to say, yes, this is a fundus fluorescein angiography of the right eye of the patient. I can say it's the right eye because here is the optic disc, here is the macula, and this is indicating that this is an image of the right eye or the left eye. And then you can explain that there is a region of area of interest or abnormality located in the macula, and you can describe, so there is leaking or there is hyperfluorescence. So you should be able to be comfortable with what are the normal pathologies. Now, how do you get that knowledge? Because not everybody will have access to all these images in whatever the ophthalmic postings they've had or whatever exposure they've had. So you have to see what is the kind of a clinical access you have. Otherwise, you can rely on textbooks and most textbooks will give you a reasonable amount of images, and you can look at them and try to get practice in describing those images per se, and develop a mental library of images. Plus, there are a lot of online resources also. If you want to say, particularly you feel a little weak in, say, interpreting fundus, florus, and angiogram, you can look online and look at different pathologies. You can say, feed in for images of various disorders, and you will get some images. And generally, there are a good number of ophthalmic textbooks where, if you look carefully at the images, you will be able to get a lot of information even by looking at the legends.
Right. So, one is remember looking at the images carefully, and then there is trying to remember all of that. So, do you have any strategies in terms of retention technique for the exam? Any mnemonic devices that we can let students know, just so that, you know, they can quickly remember these concepts during the exams, or revise rather?
Yes. So actually, I sometimes find that for this kind of exposure, mnemonics will be more complicated to remember all, because there's so many mnemonics that you'll have to memorize. So I would say that you should first know how to describe what is the image. And that is usually, if you have looked at your textbooks carefully and focused on the information given in the clinical pictures given in your textbooks, you should be fairly confident to say what is the investigation, such as visual fields, automated visual fields, or a Goldmund perimetry, or whether it is optic disc imaging using OCT, or whether it's a retinal image, which is there. So all that is fairly straightforward, and so you are confident there. Then you have to, you should start by describing what is the nature of the image, what is it showing, and then you go to the abnormalities. Now, when talking about the abnormalities, talk about broad things first. Because if you immediately identify something as, say, proliferative diabetic retinopathy, but actually that patient may not have diabetes at all. You may get a similar pattern of new vessels which are leaking due to other disorders as well, such as it could have been an old central retinal vein occlusion following which there was ischemia and there's a proliferative retinopathy. It could also be a case of branch retinal vein occlusion earlier, which has now got the proliferative retinopathy. So first talk about broad base. So I say an area of neovascularization, which is in the superior temporal quadrant, or involving the inferior temporal vasculature, and this looking at, then you look at other associated features. If you see microaneurysms, you see some exudates, which are suggestive of a diabetic. Considering all this, I feel that diabetic retinopathy is my most likely diagnosis, but I would like to know the age of the patient, because the same thing in a young person may sometimes also be due to vasculitis, it may be due to Eales disease, you may get a similar pattern, whereas if it's an older person who has diabetes, it could be diabetic retinopathy. So you have to have a very clinical oriented practical approach,
right? So
always remember that all the marks are not for hitting on the right diagnosis, because it's an artificial situation that you've just been given an image. Normally you'll have a patient, you'll have the history, everything, but if you're given a short case or a spotter, we're given an artificial situation, so you will have a little bit of background information, and then you have to walk yourself through it, and you can even ask for clinical context. But if it is a spotter, there is no answering there, or sometimes even in an MCQ you may be given an image where you cannot even interact with anybody, you cannot even discuss. So then you have to see, and usually questions will be framed in such a way that so don't get nervous if you're not sure. Then try to see what is the best fit answer depending upon the clinical scenario.
When you speak about the format of the question, so what is generally the format of the questions asked in a paper, and are they more clinical, more diagram based, and the new rules have also come around NEET PG, they have to complete a section of the paper in a 40 minutes time. So how does one cope up with that?
Yes. So this is difficult for students at the moment. Initially, it may seem overwhelming, or it may seem extremely difficult. But when you are studying, there are certain disorders which are given priority, and that you can make out from the checklist which is given in the National Medical Commission guidelines. So based on that, you know what are the important, there are the must-know areas and the essential, and what you have to be able to demonstrate, what you have to be able to recall. So that part you have to do a little bit of a focused studying. And then those areas you have to think of possible ways that you could be asked. So, for example, diabetic retinopathy is a very important area because not all people will become ophthalmologists. We want that everybody should have a basic knowledge because diabetes is very prevalent, and it's extremely important that it be detected early so that proper treatment can be given at the proper time. So for diabetic retinopathy, for example, it's a very important area, and there you should be able to identify what are the features, what are the clinical features. You should be able to indicate that which kind of retinopathy is, does it require immediate referral or not. So when looking at those topics, so I would suggest that they should make a list of these important topics that they know, because you can't keep going back to the website and checking. So you first study the whole requirements, and you make your own list that this is the checklist that I have to cover. And then the questions will be asked in different ways, because it's not always possible to show a patient to everybody. So certain aspects will be covered with clinical pictures. Certain aspects will be covered with this little history. For example, you may be given a paragraph that there is a 55-year-old patient with uncontrolled diabetes who has now presented with sudden painless diminution of vision in one eye. You know, that may be one scenario. Another scenario would be, so they will say, what are the possibilities? And then you may be asked to write down certain differentials. You may have to write certain, or what would you do next? What would you specifically look for in investigations? Or they may say that on examination, the patient has proliferative diabetic retinopathy. Now, what will be the next steps? So you have to know that apart from the eye investigations, you also have to ask for systemic investigations, because uncontrolled diabetes, if left uncontrolled, is going to further escalate. And also, you may have associated comorbidities like hypertension. So if you have a combination,
Ma'am, we can't hear you. Yeah, now we can hear Ma'am, you were speaking about, so like you said, there's time and they have to make a checklist. But while they are in the examination, students due to the exam pressure, they tend to make certain mistakes that can be easily avoided. Can you know, what are these common mistakes to look out for in the paper and how to avoid them? If you can give some tips on that.
Yes. So this is true that during the exam they have a lot of pressures, and they are very nervous and often worried that how will I finish all the questions in time. So certain common mistakes are that you may skip a question. So always make sure you're systematic. And I know there is a tendency for some people to go backwards and forwards, that they'll do the easier question first and they will try to come back to the question later, and in the confusion sometimes they may miss out a question. So I would recommend try to go in sequence. If there's something you don't know too well, you put that answer to question number three, and you write something there, leave a little bit of space, and then go to the next so that you can come back and write a little bit more. Because sometimes people, they feel they don't know anything about it, and they leave it completely blank. They don't answer anything, and then it's very difficult for anybody to give marks if nothing has been written. So it's very important, and it's never going to happen that you're given such an esoteric or such an odd question that you don't know anything about it. So when preparing for an exam, firstly, of course, you have the checklist about the important topics and concepts. But in addition, whatever textbook you're using for ophthalmology, just make sure you go through all the headings of the chapters, or any every chapter you can at least go through the headings, even if you don't read everything in detail, if you're not having time, so that at least you're familiar, and nothing is going to be so detailed that it's going to be in some small print somewhere. So make sure you're first. So it'll never happen that you get something that you have no clue what it is about. And then sometimes people make a mistake that they don't understand the question. Like, for example, if there is a specific marks given for the question may appear to be the same. Like one is, it'll say discuss the possible causes for. So we'll discuss the possible causes for, say, acute red eye in a 30-year-old patient, unilateral acute red eye, 30-year-old. So when you see the word discuss, it means that apart from listing, you have to also write a little bit of interpretation. You know, so that if it is this, it is this, like that. Sometimes it will be write the differential diagnosis and discuss any one in detail. So then you don't write all of them in detail. Then they lose their time because they have written all of them in detail. So first you list them, and when they say discuss any one, you will write only that. So read the question, because there is a certain reason why the question has been framed in that way. Or they'll say that what could be the possible management of a case of acute angle closure glaucoma. So there you have to write big headings: control intraocular pressure, and ask for further investigations, medical treatment, and so on, things like that. So it's very important to understand what is being asked and answer to the point. The other point is that if they say explain with the help of diagrams, so then you mustn't write too much of written material. Write the diagram, and you can put an arrow and then explain with the help of those arrows. So you should be very comfortable with drawing a simple diagram of these conditions, so that it makes it simpler for you to write, to answer, and you don't feel nervous about answering the question.
Right.
But the biggest mistake is not answering anything. Because if you have answered something which is reasonably correct, you will definitely get some marks. But if you left it blank, then it's impossible to give any marks.
Write something and write, look at the question properly and write just what is being asked, not to elaborate, not to just cover all the questions.
Right.
Ma'am, anything from your personal experience, anything that you would like to, share with students from your academic experience of teaching children for so many years?
Yes. So my personal experience is that everybody has their own likes and dislikes in terms of subjects, and sometimes some subjects can seem very dry. It can seem like boring, or it's too detailed. So and different students have their own talents, capacities, and ability. It's not everybody cannot be the same. So I would say that students who love studying, there are students who love studying, and it's very easy for them. They will naturally find the way, and they will have no trouble. But yes, it is some students who find studying a burden. So for them, I will say that you should firstly remember that the importance of this subject is so that you can at least have an idea how to help a patient or know how to refer. So when you keep that clinical context, it helps you to understand that this is how you solve the issue of the patient. The idea is to help the patient and make a diagnosis and give the treatment. And then what is useful is that you start looking at the sort of organization of the book. You see what are the chapters, sub-chapters, headings, subheadings, and you try to look at the pictures and get some idea. And sometimes if certain concepts are too dry, you can discuss them with either a friend, or you can discuss it with any colleague, or sometimes you can even find online resources where there is a verbal or a sort of a audio visual description. So sometimes they do find it boring to read a book. So there you can certain concepts you can even try looking at online resources. And one more thing I would say, nothing like the classroom teaching. Because whenever you're in the classroom, I know people feel that they can read, but what happens is when you are attending a class, you have an experienced teacher who has made the effort to crystallize the information in a nutshell. So you may think that, yes, I can of course read it on my own, but the benefit of attending the class is you have a person who's already crystallized it for you, and you can therefore make brief notes. So of course you can, often people take pictures of the slides, but then later they don't have time to, look at all these slides that they've taken pictures of. So it's better to pay attention to what the teacher is saying and just make a few notes rather than spending all your time, because then you're distracted from paying attention to what they're saying, and you're busy taking pictures of the slide, or not paying attention. So that is another important thing I would suggest.
Pay attention in the class, basically.
Yeah.
All right, ma'am, I think that was all from our side. Those were all the questions. And thank you for your time today, everyone. I hope you enjoyed the session. If you have any questions related to this session or any other previous sessions that we have had, you can share them with us and we can get in touch with the authors and get them responded to you. Our next session will be on 21st of May with Dr. Shruti Dhingra, who's the author of Diseases of Ear, Nose and Throat, and we will keep you posted on that soon. Thank you so much, ma'am, for your time, and
Thank
it
you.
was very interesting to hear all of what you said. I hope it helps all the students. Thank you,
Thank you
ma'am.
so much. Lovely opportunity.
Thank you,
Bye-bye.
ma'am. Bye-bye.